being here. Your presence tells us that these are important questions that we're going to ask together today. A little bit of housekeeping. Today is a full day and we must keep to our schedule, but please come and go as you need to and take care of your needs. And there are restrooms in the back, and there's an all gender restroom labeled around this way. If you need caffeination, there are two coffee shops right around the corner. Also, you should know that our keynote and panels are being live streamed at HowlRound TV, so please, you know, if there are people who you think should see this, text them and say, tune into HowlRound TV. And if you're tweeting, Facebooking, Instagramming about the event, including the show tonight, please hashtag TuftsRCD2017. For those of you who signed up for transportation to Oberon, we will distribute tickets to a dinner time over there from 6 to 7 p.m. The buses leave here. They don't get on the bus at 7:30, it leaves here at 7:30, so please be here in time. And the buses back from the Oberon leave at 10:15, and it will leave without you if you're not on it. You're welcome to take Lyfts or public transportation back, but please be on. If you were iffy about coming tonight, please take my word that it's gonna be fucking amazing. There will be a bar there. I will be beside it. And also about the show tonight. Bring an ID with you. Tip your driver performers if you can. So a little about what I had in mind when curating today, and some of my inspirations. Victor Alcaraz's web telenovela El Amor en Tiempos de Trump combines melodrama, joteria, dark comedy, and science fiction to tell stories of a group of queer Latinos accessing pleasure both through sex play, decadent foods, and by laughing at the foul ways that Latinx migrants were invoked during the 2017 U.S. elections. These strange and humorous episodes remind us that desire and pleasure must be analyzed through a critique of racial inequality, and that national politics come to bear on the regulation of race, gender, and sexuality. Karis's work precisely captures the convergences of this year's RCD workshop theme, queer of color criticism and performance. In his landmark book, Aberrations in Black, Towards a Queer of Color Critique, Roderick Ferguson argues that sexual and gender distinctions work in tandem with fictions and materialities of race and class to secure white heterocapitalist interests and futures. He pairs it with his historiography of the discipline of sociology, Black literary texts, asking art by Black writers such as Toni Morrison, Audre Lorde, and James Baldwin to serve as evidence when state-sanctioned forms of empiricism foreclose various forms of Black subjecthood. Artistry then serves not only as criticism, but makes room for more kinds of subjecthoods, pleasures, and survivals. But as we consider the promise of artistry, performance is a strange beast. For queer people of color carry what Jose Esteban Munoz calls the burden of liveness, the expectation to be the body and only the body, to entertain to the brink of exhaustion, to acquire value only in our fleshiest forms. And yet, artists such as Victor Alcaraz and Nick Kay find ways to eschew and obscure the pleasure we might want to take in watching their bodies, while making performance that is categorically beautiful, at least to me. They use their bodies to direct our gaze towards the systems that classify, derogate, and manage their bodies, asking through performance, and these are Nick's words, why must we be hashtag carefree and hashtag joy-filled? Who does this abrupt shift from hashtag Black Lives Matters and hashtag say her name conversations truly benefit? In a culture of speedier recovery and self-help as the state cuts and destroys affordable health care. What you'll hear today, or what I think you'll hear in our panel's keynote and performance showcase, is that while this devastating moment of neoliberal white supremacy feels peculiarly painful, it lives in a continuum with and echoes other ongoing processes of colonization, processes that assault, abject, and abandon people, bodies, desires, and ways of feeling deemed non-normative. In this ongoing crisis, can queer and trans of color artists save us before the state kills them? I want to say that I'm posing this dark question facetiously, but if we consider the recently publicized theft of a black trans filmmaker Rena Gossett's intellectual and artistic property, a theft facilitated by producers, funding institutions, archivists, and web-based media sites, we see how queer and trans artists of color are left in housing insecurity while white cis male artists receive support. But today I know I can trust you with the artists and scholars whose work I so deeply respect to help us think through difficult questions. So please help me welcome Dr. Adriana Zavala, Director of the Consortium in Studies of Race, Colonialism, and Diaspora, and Professor of Art History, who will introduce our keynote speaker. Thank you.
Kareem Kupchandani has done an amazing job of thanking all of the people that need to be thanked, so I'm going to eliminate that part of my paper here. But I simply want to second my thanks. I want to give a shout out, of course, to the speakers and the artists who are with us here today. Thank you for coming to Tufts. I especially want to thank Kareem for curating this extraordinary day. It's been an incredible work in progress, seeing how it's developed, and it's going to be an extraordinary day. So thank you so much, Kareem, for your vision, for your creativity, and for your courage. I also want to thank Cynthia Sanders, who is attempting to get more food for us. She is the program administrator for the Consortium of Studies in Race, Colonialism, and Diaspora, and we couldn't do any of what we do without Cynthia Sanders. So thank you very much, Cynthia, in absentia. So it's my pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker, Dr. Juana Maria Rodriguez, whose lecture, Diasporic Divas, Working Sex, Transing Biography, will open our symposium today. I am personally so excited to hear her speak. Dr. Rodriguez is professor of ethnic and gender and women's studies at the University of California, Berkeley. She's also faculty in the Performance Studies graduate group at Berkeley. And before joining Berkeley, she taught at UC Davis and Bryn Mawr. As no doubt many of you today know, Dr. Rodriguez is an interdisciplinary scholar whose work is positioned at the intersection of ethnic studies and feminist and queer theory. Her work explores the social and psychic intricacies of racialized sexuality in diverse cultural sites. Her research has contributed to several significant intellectual currents, including a renewed emphasis on the role of the sexual in queer theory, Latinx and Latin American studies in gender and sexuality, theorizations of racialized affect and the sensorial, intersectional feminist sexual politics and public policy, and performative approaches to the study of racialized sexuality. Her scholarly accomplishments are many. She's the author of two books, Queer Latinidad, Identity Practices, Discursive Spaces, published in 2003 by New York University Press, and Sexual Futures, Queer Gestures and Other Latina Longings, also New York University Press, 2014. And this second book was awarded the Alan Bray Memorial Book Prize by the Modern Language Association, GLQ Caucus, in 2015. She has a third book under contract with Duke, titled Puta, Seeing Latinas Working Sex, which traces the figure of the Latina sex worker across a range of visual modes of biographical representation to explore how different forms of documentation transform our effective encounters with the sexual lives of Latina subjects. And she has another book project in preparation titled Bisexuality and the Feminist Future of Queer Racial Politics. And this other book considers the possibilities of redirecting queer politics toward reproductive rights, the decriminalization of sex work, recognition of alternative kinship structures, asylum and immigration rights, and criminal justice reform. Her work couldn't be more timely. In addition, Dr. Rodriguez has published an impressive array of scholarly essays and creative work and blogs. She's a frequent public speaker in academic, arts, and community venues with appearances on NPR's Latino USA, Canadian TV News, Página 12 in Buenos Aires, and NBCnews.com. Her work demonstrates her commitment to public engagement on issues of sexuality, race, gender, public policy, and social justice. So it is a distinct honor to host her Please join me in welcoming Dr. Juana Maria Rodriguez.
Thank you so much for having me. Again, more thanks. Just to the faculty, the staff, all of you that came, and to Kareem, who should organize everything for the rest of eternity. Except girlfriend looks, you know, so sharp that just, okay. I'm dealing with that.
Okay.
So, we good? Now we're good. The paper I'm presenting today is new work from my new book project called Puta, Seeing Latinas Working Sex. It's organized around the image of la puta, the whore, the perennial figure of Latinized feminine sexual incest. This project interrogates how forms of biographical production organized around Latinas in various forms of, involved in various forms of sex work, attempt to make knowable experiences of sexualized embodiment across the lifespan. So in the larger project, I explore diverse visual modes of biographical representation, the identity papers of the state, the illustrated biography, the documentary film, the photojournalistic essay, and the digital traces left on social media. I'm interested in those moments where the narrative voice and visual representation collide. Specifically, the project asks, how does biographical narration productively trouble our engagement with visual depictions of racialized sexuality? And conversely, how does the visual presence of the speaking subject unsettle the textual imprints she might also leave behind? So this presentation does come with a warning. So my talk today is about a person and an idea. The idea is that we might be able to tell stories about ourselves, or even about other people, in ways that convey something real and meaningful. This is the idea, or perhaps the story, that we would like to believe, that representation is possible, that if we try hard enough, if we choose our words wisely, they will carry our desires for recognition, for connection, human and otherwise, across the vast expanses between us. But perhaps we have come to learn, painfully and with great difficulty, that the stories we perform move in social and material worlds where other fictions and feelings also roam. No matter how hard we try, we're always being misunderstood, misrecognized, misinterpreted. Our stories are never fully our own. The languages we speak, the bodies we inhabit, the gestures we offer, and the spaces we travel have been produced by everything that has preceded us, by other stories and phantasmatic projections, even as the fresh moment of the now works to make them original again and again. In their eloquent introduction to a special issue of Women in Performance Studies, Joshua Guzman and Cristina León offer us lingering as a methodological mode of engagement. They write, lingering as a verb demands a kind of languor, a dwelling that inhabits the spaces of ambivalence and ambiguity. If Latinidad enacts a problem for gender, sexuality, the nation state, for unity and so on, then lingering becomes a critical practice in meditating upon the possibilities of an impasse. For this presentation, I ask that you indulge me in this desire to linger, to sit with the feminine feelings of opening for and with another, to take in the sensory possibilities of the now. I want to tell you a story about a person, Adela Vasquez, a real living person with a scent and a style and an amazing past. Because even if we know that stories are mediated and constructed, we know they do things in the world. Through the promise of imagination, stories create new conditions of being. They ignite memories that are not uniquely our own. They have the power to activate novel ways of seeing the worlds around us. So this paper is both about imagining the queer futures that Adena's stories of her past might make possible, and lingering in the present performative impacts that they might also reveal. Adena's life story is the subject of Sexilium, a bilingual graphic biography by Jaime Cortés that also functions as a kind of queer, diasporic, trans testimonio. Testimonial literatures name a hybridized genre that capture elements of the African-American oral tradition of testifying, the legal discourse of testimony, and the genre of life story as evidence in the public claim for the human rights of the disenfranchised. Reading Sexilio as testimonio makes salient the queer, racialized sexual politics that undergird Adela's story. Following John Beverly's foundational work on testimonio, this text could be said to use Adela's biography to offer a fuller understanding of the life experiences of a population that has been erased or misrepresented in public discourse, to make a claim for the human rights of transgender women, sex workers, immigrants, and diasporic subjects. And very often in testimonio, as in this text, the subject recounts their story to a witness who constructs and disseminates the narrative of an individual whose life is marked as both extraordinary and intended to be representative of countless others we may never know. In his introduction to Sexilio, Jaime Cortés writes, "The life of Adela Vázquez is trans everything, transnational, transgender, transformative, and truly transfixing." Sexilio narrates Adela's journey of being assigned male at birth in Cuba, forming part of the Mariel boat lift, working as a sex worker and later as a sexual health advocate and transgender advocate in San Francisco. As I reflect on the production and dissemination of Sexilio, I am reminded of how it dutifully performs the pedagogical mandate demanded of testimonio. Published in 2004, it was funded through the Institute for Gay Men's Health and AIDS Project Los Angeles, which for many years made it available for free as a book while copies lasted, and for years later as a free digital download in Spanish or in English. In his introduction to Sexilio, Patrick Pato Hebert, who was working at APLA at the time, writes, quote, "HIV prevention is too often preoccupied with tiny pieces of what we do rather than the fullness of what we feel and the vastness of who we are becoming. Sexilio is special because it reminds us of the power of storytelling." Of course, those were the days before PrEP and the medical management of HIV and AIDS, when stories valued as medicine were still being funded. Pato Hebert, Jaime Cortés, and Adela Vázquez are all part of what Hebert calls the diasporic folk of Proyecto Village, a reference to Proyecto Contra Sida Por Vida, a Latinx HIV prevention agency where I first met Adela, Jaime, Pato, and so many others, and which I wrote about in my first book, Queer Latinidad. So while Adela's story is narrated in the familiar as-told-to style, so central to testimonio, the author is neither an anthropologist nor an enlightened foreign intellectual. Instead, in the introduction, Jaime Cortés, himself a queer Latino and Adela's friend, describes his own insecurities as an illustrator, writer, and researcher, and narrates his own investment in the story. He writes, "When the fear and uncertainty came a-knocking, I turned back to the transcripts of my interviews with Adela to remind myself why I need this story to be in the world. Not just because I'm a queer, a child of immigrants, or a lover of both comics and sexual narratives, that because this story is so fucked up, fabulous, raggedy, and human, that it opens a vast space where we can all ponder our own sense of risk, exile, and home. Cortés sees his labor, all 800 hours of it, not as a work of detached altruism designed to promote the human rights of others, but as part of his desire, his need, to create a capacious space for imagining his own life. I should also note that Avena is my friend too. So the intimacy and friendship that the text performs, that this text performs, is one that implicates the subject, the narrator, and the critic. All of us bound together in a kind of queer kinship through our shared work with Proyecto. In Sexilio, Adela's story begins, not to brag, but my birth was revolutionary. Adela was born in Camagüey, Cuba in 1958 in the rural countryside of one of the country's interior provinces on the eve of the Cuban Revolution. Sexuality is lived differently in the countryside. It is seen and sensed outdoors. Early on in the story, Adela states, I was fascinated by farm sex, cow sex, chicken sex, insect sex. Then she proceeds to describe how she used to fuck this one banana tree. So, on the next page, we get this. The top says, the tree got boring, and I graduated to humans. I used farm temptations to get sex. And the panels below describe how the young Adela would lure her classmates to the barn with the promise of sex with the goat, and then offer herself in exchange. Do you want to put your thing in me instead? Now, these stories of banana trees, farm temptations, and nine-year-olds having penetrative sex might seem spectacular and foreign, or perhaps horrifying to some, but what is immediately clear is none of that is how it appears to Adela. This is her story of childhood sexuality, her terms of narrative engagement. Farther down, we get this. 9 years old and I was pimping a goat to get laid. And you know what? That goat was not even that cute if you really look at the bitch. Oh, child, I was such a manipulating liar, but I couldn't help it because even then, I would do anything for sex. Besides, it was great revenge. How getting fucked by a boy who thought he was coming to fuck a goat is about getting revenge? Well, that part isn't exactly spelled out. It should already be clear that Adela is rarely interested in how we might read her story, what sense or nonsense we might make of the story she tells. But perhaps, if we linger, we might imagine the ways the boys might have treated the nine-year-old who grew up to be Adela. And we might conjure why she might want to exact revenge in this moment of her childhood or in the recitation of the scene of youthful sexuality years later. This panel also visually represents the orality upon which the book is premised. That unlike its function in much of testimonial literature, where the transcription of the oral marks an illiterate subject, here, orality registers friendship and the importance of storytelling in the formation of queer community. Or as Lisa Kekaloli Chang Hall writes, I have a theory that gay identity is really founded on storytelling and gossip, not sex. That in fact, people often have sex so that we can talk about it. I think Lisa was really right on it. In the text, we hear the speaking subject speaking, and through humor and rhetorical gesture, the reader is brought into the intimacy of the exchange, into a moment of shared friendship. In the bottom panel, Cortés allows us to visually step outside of the time of the story and returns us to the time of the present, or at least the present that he's in. We see Adela smoking a cigarette in the comfort of her San Francisco apartment, and you sort of see how the smoke curls into the panel above. The tea and cookies suggesting that this was a long, leisurely exchange between documentarian and speaking subject. Graphic novels make possible the visual juxtaposition of different temporal registers coexisting on the same page. For this text, those shifts transport us across not only time, illustrating a then and a now, but also across genders and geographies, even as we remain within the narrative sphere of Adela's life story. While much of the text documents Adela's life in Cuba from before her exodus, several passages record the periods in her life when sex was less about desire and more about sex as a commodity. The image in the top left is Adela having recently arrived in Fort Chaffee, Arkansas, the improvised refugee camp for where many Marielitos were deposited after she had suffered a brutal beating before leaving Havana. On the prior page, she tells us that having been unable to find a bed in the overcrowded barracks, Adela sits on a bench under the stars. A stranger approaches her and says, "Hey, Mama, why is that nice face so sad tonight?" In the panel we see here, the stranger informs her that having been in Fort Chaffee a month, he's now the barracks czar, a position that includes the benefits of a private shower. In these moments of seeing Adela in masculine drag, I meet a person I've never met before. But I confess, this is an insight I came to in writing about the text, not in my initial reading of it. Literature and fantasy train us to jump back and forth into different temporal registers, to inhabit different bodies and perspectives effortlessly. On the following page, in a full page spread, I am returned to the Adela that I know at the time of Cortes's interview, and the dialogue reflects back on her early days in the camp. "I was a wreck child, tore up, beat down, dirty, hungry, tired, but after just 48 hours in the USA, I had a puppy and a private crib. All I needed was a poodle and a picket fence. I was so exhausted, I almost didn't realize he was seducing me. But then I realized, and I thought, I know this, it's beauty and sex getting me what I need. Different country, same exchange. Pussy power, baby, pussy power." Rather than essentializing a connection between feminine sexual labor and genitalia, Vasquez's text disrupts it, even as it links sexual labor to the heterosexual domestic family of the fantasy of the American dream, a poodle and a picket fence. Pages later, in a chapter called Legal Tender, Adela, now established in Los Angeles with a gay Cuban sponsor, begins a more formal relationship with sex work. Makeup, drugs, clothes, hormones, food, and 1 million other expenses. It was hard to keep up with my salary from sewing work. I wasn't living rent-free anymore, so Mama needed to capitalize big time. So I said, fuck it, and went and took hoochie pictures, and then I put an ad in the Ho-Rag, Hollywood Connections, to see if I could get some business. In the top panel, alongside this lament, we see the actual ad Adela used to promote her sexual services. Capitalizing on her difference, she describes herself as a, quote, exotic Cuban shemale. I told you there would be offensive language. We might all agree that the text is cringeworthy, but she makes clear that it worked to pay the rent. And as in the episode with the goat, readers can leave their judgments aside. The inclusion of an actual photographic clipping in the text performs a kind of doubling, where the subject of representation is situated in the presence of her own image. And as she states in the panel below, the response was off the hook. even if the number one request was for the surprise down south. But in the bottom right panel, we also glimpse her boredom and frustration at performing the tired narrative of racialized transgender exoticism. Positioned together on a single page within the context of a graphic depiction of her life, we can ask, which is the real Avena? On the next page, even as she tells us that Mama figured out a whole menu and prices for everything, ka-ching, 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 we also learned that Avena had tired of having sex be her job. I was a great fuck, but a lousy hoe. I hated it when they wanted to have dinner first. I'm not trying to date your ass, Sonso. So awkward. As a prostitute, I had no sexual freedom. I was a product, a service, an idea, but never really a human being. Sometimes I think, my God, I used to be a math teacher. Within the context of my own writing project, Avena's story of using sex to pay the bills reminds readers that sex work as a kind of temporary employment is actually the norm. Few people grow old working in the profession, although, of course, some do. The retirement package really sucks. The sense of alienation and objectification from her labor that Avena describes in this passage directly mirrors Karl Marx's thoughts on the estranged labor that permeates capitalist production when he writes, "The worker therefore only feels herself outside her work, and in her work feels outside herself." Apart from how these stories speak to the labor of sex work, Avena's larger narrative articulates the other ways that we see Latinas work sex, as it illustrates the different kinds of things for which sex and sexuality can be exchanged: pleasure, shelter, money. In her book, Queen for a Day, Marcia Ochoa, another queer child of Proyecto's diasporic village, writes, "Glamour, beauty, and femininity are technologies with specific practices that result in social legibility, intimate power, and potentially physical survival in a hostile environment." Here, alongside Marcia's quote, is a photograph of Avena, working sex, translating what Ochoa calls transnational economies of desire and consumption into a strapless outfit, a flowered updo, a pink and orange makeup palette, a particularly feminine gesture of registering interest and aloofness simultaneously. Go something like this. The year is 1991. If until now you had only glimpsed Avena through Jaime Cortés's comic illustration, this image presents another view, one that captures a particular moment and style, 13 years before the release of Sexilio. The photograph also reveals how glamour functions as its own kind of sexual labor. This look took work. I pause here because the visual presence of Avena in living color has entered the room, and it is precisely that moment that I'm interested in marking. What does it mean to see Avena outside the narrative frame of the testimonio that Cortés has provided? How are his drawings of her related to the image we see here, or the image of her that you had already conjured? What might it mean to read her image in all of the queerest senses of the word alongside her story? Perhaps, like me, you're finding it hard to look away from those perfectly lined pink lips. Images invite us to linger, and having taken in as much as we can, the presence of an image can begin to demand more. Nowadays, when we want to probe deeper into the visual archive of someone's life, we look to Facebook. Or more likely for this generation, Instagram. And Adela's Facebook page does not disappoint. In the profile picture, her hair is blonde and short, her chosen name, Adela Cuba. Here, the designer sunglasses perform their own kind of shade. While her feed is cluttered with the usual collection of political and personal rants and raves, Adela also maintains a photo album that she has entitled The Amazing Past, a personal visual archive of her larger-than-life history. How are the narrative conventions of testimonio undone in a digital age when each of us can document our own lives complete with images, stories, and silences? If the digital, with its overload of sights and sounds, doesn't necessarily get us any closer to the real, what does it instantiate? Here we see Adela strutting her stuff for the camera and her audience. This is Esta Noche, a broke-down, dive queer Latino bar, the last queer Latino bar to close in San Francisco. In his meditation, The Dirt That Haunts, looking at Esta Noche, Ivan Ramos reflects on a photograph of the sign where Esta Noche used to be, lingering in what he terms the ghostly afterlives of a queer Latino space that meant so much to so many, including to Adela. But here in these photographs, we are transported to a time before gentrification and the white re-territorialization of the Mission District. Esta Noche is open for business, packed with the possibility of action, and Adela is silently belting out a song. In this Facebook folder, most of the images, like these, have been digitized from actual printed photographs. Right? Those were a thing. Some cropped, many include captions added through the haze of memory. I want to stop and linger on her hair just for a moment and the ways that hair marks her racially in these photographs in ways that might appear different from what we've seen before. We also see hair as labor. In the bottom right, we see her without makeup and with curlers, rolos in her hair, a visual testament to both the labor and the magic of glamour. Among her many other skills, at one point in her life, Adela was a hairdresser. That these images required an additional level of labor, including affective labor, to digitize and caption marks their significance, even if that significance is never fully provided to those who stumble across them. Their significance, like the earlier moment of narrating revenge, is something we can only speculate. What does Adela see in these younger images of herself that she wants to share or remember or document? All of these efforts at curating her life visually serve as a testament to her impulse to give her memories material substance, even if that substance is digital. But while Adela may lack many things, most importantly a job at the moment, what she does not lack is documentation. Before appearing in Sexilio, she was interviewed for a public radio program on transgender women in San Francisco. She was also featured in Proyecto's promotional materials, including the image shown here that I reproduced in my book, Queer Latinidad. She was also interviewed by the late oral historian Horacio Roque Ramirez and appeared in the 2009 documentary Diagnosing Difference about Transgender Women in San Francisco. Let's listen. Let's see if this works.
This one's never passing. This is passing. It's a word that discriminates us immensely not everybody can pass. And passing is something that the doctors will tell you to do. You try to pass. Well, no matter how much I pass, I will never be a biological woman. How about empowering me as a transgender woman that I am?
If up until now you have had my body inhabit her voice and speak her quoted text, now you have the grain of her voice, the cadence of her accent, to add to the sensory archive of Aleda's biography. That was almost 8 years ago, and she seems to be performing mature matron for the camera, blonde again, including highlighted eyebrows, more subdued makeup, sporting transparent pink reading glasses that mark the age of anyone over 40. I can assure you she is not that subdued in person, not really. I recall Sandra Cisneros' short story about when you're 11, you're also 10 and 9 and 8 and 7 and 6. Adela will turn 60 next year, but she's also the 30-something performing at Esta Noche, the 22-year-old Marielito washing up on shore, the 9-year-old pimping goats. In 2014, Adela appeared on the cover of San Francisco Weekly in a feature article by Juliana Delgado Lopero that developed into a bilingual book of collected oral histories on queer Latinx immigrants. That close-up photograph captures precisely the kinds of details we might try to hide as we age. The weight of lines around the eyes, the texture of aging skin, but her hair is purple, and it matches her lipstick perfectly. 50-ish, fierce, fabulous, a punk puta who really does not give a shit what you think about how she looks. When those interviews became a book, Cuéntamelo, the cover image chosen was another one of Adela's glam shots from years gone by. The arch of the eyebrow performing its own singular drama. Inside are seven brief first-person narratives with illustrated drawings, and once again, we get an illustration of Adela, this time the artist Laura Cerrón's rendering of her presence. In 2015, Adela was once again the subject of an oral history for the book Queer Brown Voices, Personal Narratives of Latina, Latino, LGBT Activists, edited by Uriel Quesada, Leticia Gomez, and Salvador Vidal Ortiz. In her preface, Gomez talks about the problems of translation and mediation that oral histories instantiate, and specifically calls out editorial issues that arose with elements of Adela's oral history. It seems that at one point in the interview, conducted in English and published in, conducted in Spanish and published in English, Adela talks about women born females and normal women in ways that made the editors rightfully uncomfortable. Another moment of Adela authored cringeworthy text. Yet because those comments were voiced by a trans woman, the editors decided to faithfully reprint the interview. I tried to imagine the interviewer wanting to interrupt Adela's monologue, perhaps trying to use her utterance as a pedagogical moment to make a point about language, normativity, and transgender embodiment. But Adela is old school and stubborn, not up on the latest queer lingo of cis, and most likely not in the mood to be schooled. Last year I had students work on a Wikipedia project to document queer of color figures, the minor figures that mean so much to so many. And after reading Sexidio, a student created a Wikipedia page for Adela because nothing says notable like having a Wikipedia page. If you've been keeping track, that makes at least seven separate accounts of Adela's life. each one a partial, problematic, rich, and imprecise attempt at biographical representation. Rather than capturing the subject's unique difference, these variegated gestures of recognition enact the inherent impossibility of representing alterity. Representation invariably falls short, producing both an absence that is never fully capable of capturing the psychic contours of embodied subjectivity, and an excess that is produced through the performative possibilities of interpretation and, yes, misinterpretation. The hardest part, certainly for academics, or perhaps it's the most comforting, is that even in the presence of the biographical subject, even if Adela was here with us now, representing herself, we wouldn't really know her, not completely. And maybe that's as it should be. In giving an account of oneself, Judith Butler writes, precisely my own opacity to myself occasions my capacity to confer a certain kind of recognition onto others. End quote. What would it mean to allow others the kind of inscrutability that the affective messiness of our own lives demand? If we understand social relations take place within a field of power, Caribbean theorist Edouard Glissant invites us to rethink the underlying dynamics of our encounters with alterity. As the subject of colonial spectacle, who is at once fully exposed and wholly invisible, Glissant is not invested in being faithfully represented, but in affirming his resistance to having his difference determined. In his text, The Poetics of Relation, Glissant, like Butler decades later, deploys the idea of opacity as a way to resist the move to know, comprehend, and capture the other. Glissant writes, agree not merely to the right to difference, but carrying this further, agree also to the right to opacity. For Glissant, opacity, or the refusal of transparency, is precisely what might allow a fuller acknowledgement of social relations. Glissant affirms that the right to opacity becomes the necessary precondition that might make the vulnerability and heartbreak demanded of human connection possible. For Glissant, opacity allows us to see the other, to register their difference, but it also stops short of ascribing a meaning to that difference. Rather than totalizing forms of knowledge production, the argumentative demands of theory, or even the persuasive potential of compelling interpretations, Glissant offers us poetics as another way to cling to the affective potentiality that our desires for representation might also engender. Butler writes, as we ask to know the other, or ask the other, say infinitely or definitively, who he or she is, it will be important not to expect an answer that will ever satisfy. By not pursuing satisfaction and letting the question remain open, even enduring, we let the other live, since life might be understood as precisely that which exceeds any account we may try to give of it. In the ruins of representation, there is feeling. The sense of the corporeal that also leaves its trace in the archive. In the introduction to Feeling Photography, Elsbeth Brown and Tai Fu acknowledge that studies of image making that have emphasized representation and the disciplinary construction of meaning have, quote, generally been less instructive in providing a full account of alterity, end quote. Instead, they suggest that, quote, focus on feeling allows photo scholars a rich theoretical terrain to reimagine relationships, the complex relationship between images, power, and subjects. Reading and seeing for feeling rather than for meaning opens a rich interpretive space that challenges the evidentiary logics of knowledge production. Following our querido José Esteban Muñoz as a methodological mode of interpretation, lingering in the sensorial spaces that feeling pry open registers a queer form of evidence, and evidence that has been queered in relation to the laws of what counts as proof. Focusing on feeling performs its own refusal of transparency. It performs a kind of knowledge production that is at ease in unknowing. It invites a lingering in ambiguity and ambivalence. As a methodological practice, feeling enacts a reckoning with the unruly practices of succumbing to memory and imagination. It asks that we open ourselves to the magic of sensation. In a digital age, the project of testimonio that Beverly described in 1998 has been forever transformed. We can no longer pretend we are giving voice to subaltern subjects or transforming the academic enterprise by constructing ever more expansive projects of representation. Yet returning to Beverly, we find another insight that resonates with my own. Rather than attempts at representation, he writes, we seek to register instead the way in which the knowledge we construct and impart is structured by the absence, difficulty, or impossibility of representation of the subaltern. This is to recognize, however, the fundamental inadequacy of this knowledge and of the institutions that contain it. End quote. Of course, it is not only the subaltern subject that exceeds the recognizable categories of knowledge production and the institutions that contain her. All of us struggle to be seen, heard, and sensed by those around us, even as we stumble in our efforts to fully account for the fullness of our lives or the feelings they inspire. Yet it is only through this reckoning with the failure of representation, in letting the question remain open, even enduring, that we might let the other live. Lately, on Facebook, Adela has taken to manipulating photographs, old and new, applying Warholian filters, smoothing the edges of age. In most of the images on Facebook, she appears as glamorous as ever. Ochoa asserts, glamour allows its practitioners to conjure a contingent space of being and belonging. But Adela's ability to produce her own images or control how they might circulate is not quite the point. Even she is unable to capture who she is or account for all that her life might signify to others or to herself. Adela is unemployed now. The nonprofit jobs have run dry or been taken over by a bright new crew of young, queer, and trans activists who know how to speak the new lingo that these jobs require. Gentrification has made San Francisco unaffordable, and the influx of privileged whiteness has made it unlivable. Adela tried to leave. She went to Florida, but had to come back to San Francisco to an uncertain future in a city that seems to have no place for her. Perhaps for now, the place of glamour in Adela's life, the contingent space of being and belonging, is Facebook. Ironically, Facebook is precisely one of sort of the tech giants responsible for the gentrification that has made life in San Francisco for people like Adela impossible. Perhaps sex stops working. But the elsewhere of youth and the memory of sexual futures that could have been inhabits the images she keeps there, even as the strain and heartbreak of living remains out of sight. Rather than produce knowledge about the other, the archives that surround Adela Vázquez's life ask that we linger in the affective traces that stories leave behind, the feelings that overflow the image. They call on us to dwell in the uncertainty of speaking, seeing, and sensing each other queerly. Thank you.
Intersection of what's recently happening with Raina Gossett and her documentary with Marsha P, and like the complexities of how critical and necessary and really mandatory it is that like we're telling our own stories, and that all of this complexity would not be shown with like somebody else who's coming from like an anthropological, like sociological, whatever academic point of view, where it's just kind of like some things are just raw and need to be told the way that they need to be told. So thank you. This is like really beautiful thought, so thank you so much.
And also, I think that film was, there was another filmmaker. It's two filmmakers. So in this retelling of like, we also have to remember that there's some, it's like Engels. No one ever calls themselves an Engelist, but you know, Engels wrote stuff too.
I was wondering if you had heard anything about her thoughts on Cuba, especially considering that she went back to Miami, so her relationship to the Cuban-American community in the U.S. I wonder if there is anything you know of that.
So Adela's a really bad subject. She doesn't perform what we want her to perform. And so she's super critical of Cuba. She's like, I am not going back. Mm-hmm. Very anti-Castro. And even now, sort of refuses to go back. And so that's not a position that I hold, right? So there is this way in which I would like her to think differently, but she doesn't. that's the thing, the idea that the people we want to represent are not just who we want to represent. They are their own complex beings. And just like those moments where she's using this really cringeworthy text, you know, that, you know, her discourse on Cuba is sort of informed by who she's listening to in the more reactionary Cuban community.
Hi, thank you so much for your incredibly, sensual, eloquent, exuberant, thoughtful presentation.
Thank you.
Yeah. My name is Claudia Castañeda, and one of the things that I really appreciated about what you said was what it means to encounter another with a sense of openness and a sense of our own lack of knowledge, regardless of what we think we're seeing as we encounter that other. And sort of related to that, and I this is really not a criticism, okay? I just want you to hear that. So you're representing Adela, who represents herself, and you're very careful.
I'm sorry, this is a
dissertation. I didn't need to speak for so long. You're representing her, and you're very careful about how you help us watch what we're seeing and how harsh it is. And I guess I was just curious about your own negotiation of, one thing I noticed was how exuberantly you represented her words. And I just wondered about your negotiation of all that in this process.
Yeah, so I'm trying to represent Adela, who I think is trying to represent herself, and talking about how we're both sort of failing, but you know, trying to be exuberant. I think I read that way because I'm a mom, and so I you know, when you read to kids, you have to like, when the characters speak, you know. And 40 minutes is a long time to give a talk, and so I want to keep you, you know, talking about farm sex and trying to keep it lively. But I do love that moment where we, like, yes, I time that moment where we hear her voice, and then all of my exuberance kind of comes undone because we have her voice now, right? And then once you hear her voice, everything else that's from her, you just hear differently. Like if you've ever heard someone speak, and then now you read them and you hear that. So yes, it, in the talk, I am trying to do this layering of what you see, and I'm trying to give you a sensory experience of the different ways we take in biographical information.
Hi, thank you so much for that wonderful keynote. So I have a kind of boring question about form and genre, I apologize.
Yeah.
So you start out by framing Sexilio as testimony and testimonio, and right. So my association with that genre and that form is
I
think
over Kamen Chu, yeah. Kind of the classic.
Right. And I mean it's all about bearing witness to violence, providing evidence, seeking a kind of retribution, right? It's a making public of violence that is hidden. But I really love how your use of lingering and of queering evidence really kind of undoes the DNA, so to speak, of that form.
Yeah.
And so I'm wondering, you know, what does thinking of it through the frame of testimony do for you, and if the genre is sort of more pliable than maybe we give it credit for?
You know, several people have asked me, like, well, what, you know, why are you framing it this way? And I think a couple of things are happening now. I think there's this overload of memoir, right? As this, like, more memoirs than, like, I think it's like the genre, right, of the 21st century. And it's always supposed to be kind of pedagogical. It's always supposed to sort of do something. And so maybe everything has become testimonio, right? Whereas if before it was this kind of exceptional, that is both supposed to be representative of the larger, but exceptional at the same time. There is this way in which, as like, aren't we all both exceptional and representative of like the different genres that we are, right? So I should probably write that down. I like that. No. but I do think that So thinking about testimonio, I think does speak to the specific way in which this text, I think, did have a pedagogical function. at, you know, Proyecto, AIDS Project LA was putting it, this was like AIDS education. And it was supposed to be somewhat representative in its exceptional, you know, in its exceptional form. I also think that the digital completely undoes testimonial, right? So, but I think we're still like using these genres of presenting life, the life story, in ways that are speaking to all four different kinds of, if not violences, forms of harm. Yeah.
Thank you, Juana. That was an amazing talk, as usual. I want to deal with this problem of witnessing and testimonio, though, precisely through thinking about sort of like the candidness of how she speaks and like not being up to date on like our latest like queer lexicon, which is a lexicon that's just like constantly updating itself, and like we just always have to be so proper as like queers. I'm wondering to what extent does that produce bad witnesses? To what extent is like queer studies no longer able to recognize the other? So like, what do we do with the messiness of these categories? And I know you've dealt with this when you're working bisexuality versus queer, but like how do we deal with this now in terms of like a queer ethics?
That's a great question. I mean, the idea that, you know, we do want our subjects. We want our subjects, we want our texts, we want our films to do what we want them to do. And when they don't, like, we either don't talk about that part or, you know, somehow try to crush it into these frames that we have. But, you know, messiness is like where all the juice is, right? I like juice. I just think it's like, you know, as scholars, like you have to, whatever you think that limit is, where like, I don't get this part, this is what I can't do, then that's actually almost like where you kind of need to start. Like, if you don't do that, then you're really, you're just using the text to fulfill your own desires, rather than being inspired or motivated to think through that messiness. Even if you present it and say, you know, shit's fucked up, I really don't know what to do with this. Because there's a lot of shit that's just fucked up that we just don't know what to do with. In scholarship and life and in the world. And so rather than try to sort of contain that or box that or set it aside, we need to sort of talk about those moments. For example, I've had, you know, young people who are precisely taking those jobs, right? It's not a bad thing. We want you, everyone needs a job, right? But this idea of like, okay, like we as scholars, we're training these young people who know this language, and they're going in, and they're, but they're also competing with Adela for these jobs, right? So that's just the kind of messy reality. Of age discrimination and how different people benefit from it. So it's those kinds of, that kind of messiness that we have to just sit with and not try to fix or, the juice.
Hi, Juana. First of all, it's so wonderful to hear from you again, and you know, I'm just so grateful that you're here.
Takeo is my student at Berkeley, has a job now.
What's up? So I think my question is in conversation with the last two in a lot of ways. So the person in back there brought the really lovely point about testimonial. And I guess it gets me to think about how, in your example, you know, contrary to the ways in which we think about testimonial, is also often solidifying a subject, we see this sort of auto-dismantling of the subject. So it seems like there's this way in which testimonial is, you're deploying it in such a way that it sort of self-destructs in ways that are really productive and, as you say, messy. But I guess my question is, what exactly do we do with the messiness when we're trying to contend with queer futurity? So I guess what I'm wondering is, what is queer futurity in your formulation, given our attraction to these ways that are, these imperfect politics, for example?
Well, the queer future is messy and juicy. wishful thinking, of course. You know. Okay. So I think it's we're supposed to figure out how to deal with that messiness and still do our work. And not always try to sort of fix everything. I think there's this constant policing of ourselves and one another that actually works against forms of solidarity and allyship and just getting shit done. Allowing ourselves to be imperfect, allowing other people, getting over disappointment. In sexual futures, I've tried to think of this idea of the gesture as like, because everything we come up with is going to get co-opted. It just will. There is no sort of perfect, pure political position, stance, posture, word that's somehow untainted. And so, frankly, I actually worry that, critique is easy, creativity is hard. Critiquing something else is really easier than coming up with something, right? And I tell students, if you're really lucky, one day it'll be your book on the seminar table. How do you want to be read, right? What does it mean to read generously? What does it mean to allow other people to try and fail and to recognize that the option was not trying? So in our politics, the option is always not trying, or it's trying and allowing yourself the vulnerability to be willing to fail. But I worry that, when we don't get it all the way right, the critique is so fast and furious and punishing that, particularly I think for younger, people just coming into political action, it can be pretty paralyzing. I did a workshop once. It was like for, sex something week at Davis. And students talked about how they had organized a workshop on lube. Because, they said, we thought like everybody uses lube. But no, not everyone uses lube. So people felt, we don't use lube. They felt erased, marginalized, not seen. So it's true. This is like a true story. So everything is not for everyone. Different people hear what you say and do in different ways, and use it as to create or transform something else. And so I'm more worried about not doing things because we're scared of getting it wrong. So I think we have to take criticism gracefully. You know, we can't like fall apart or everyone says, well, you know, you could have. But it's also important to understand what it is to try. And I get the whole intention is not the facts thing, I get that. But I'm worried about people not trying.
Thank you so much. Sorry, over here. Thank you so much for this talk. I know I'm sort of a disembodied voice. And I'm going to pick up on a line that many other people have picked up on, which is testimonio. And I think precisely the fact that so many of us are attaching to this shows you that it's a really, really valuable mode of inquiry. I was really struck, yes, Rigoberta Menchú is the sort of paradigmatic example. It's not actually the origin of testimonio, right? And one of the sort of founding figures in the field is the Cuban Michel Barnett and a story like Canción de Rachel. That's, for me, your project actually has this wonderful potential to bring testimonio back to some of its roots in a certain way that's really exciting. But I wanted to maybe push back or ask you to clarify a little bit on what I see as perhaps a kind of tech utopianism that's coming out in terms of your figuration of the digital and the way that the digital is interrupting the testimonial form. Because I feel like this is actually something that has come up again and again. So this is the phonograph, this is the tape recorder, this is whole projects, for example, Rebecca Lamoff at Harvard talks about this in terms of what the State Department thought it was going to do with technology in the middle of the 20th century.
Yeah.
It always seems to us that our new emerging technology is going to completely revolutionize the idea of mediation and allow people to speak for themselves, and it never quite gets there. So I wondered if you had more to say about that.
Well, you know, I certainly make the point that, you know, whatever tech provides, what is not providing is housing for the people still left in San Francisco. I don't know, I didn't get one. Part of what I really want to make clear is that I don't think that we're fully capable of representing ourselves, right? And so even as we see social movements around the world using digital, uploading things, live streaming, as we are now, live streaming, it's not unmediated, it's not the real, it's not the truth, it's not, liberatory, but it is. So we have to sort of, as we've done with, you know, everything from like, you know, I think of like slave narratives as a kind of testimonio, right? So, and we think of the ways in which those were mediated, what was their political effect, what did they do in the world, how were they authorized? So all of those questions, I think, are still at play. And curiously, you know, there's a lot of like, you know, if you have an iPhone and you don't have an Oscar, you know, or you're not upload, like we're not making movies or web series or something, we could be because we have the technology in our hands, we're just too lazy, right? So anyone can do this. Now, should everyone do this? The other question that I ask is, I mean, there's certainly political projects, but when I think about documentary now, and this kind of like overload of documentary, part of me wants to think about form. I would ask what happens to form, right? Is this idea that just, you know, me filming you telling your story, that that's somehow enough? What else needs to happen just to capture people's attention? Because that isn't enough anymore. So I do think that it's gotten rid of the anthropologist in a particular way. Like the anthropologist that goes up to people that, I don't think that anthropology departments are going away, but this idea of representing the subaltern, I think, has to go away. think that idea has to go away. You don't think it's going away?
I don't think that's an anthropology job.
I don't think that that's what anthropology does. But I do think that there is certainly a stream of that that Testimonio was kind of in response to that was trying to do that. I don't think that's necessarily what anthropology does now. But I think that idea that you could go out there and just document something that no one else had seen or heard, and that was producing knowledge about these people, others. I don't think that that's necessarily, it's not what, Marcia Ochoa is an anthropologist, that's not what she does. A lot of my very best friends are. But I do think at one point it was this idea of representing the other or making the unseen seen. Yeah, and I think that the moment that we're living in, technology does interrupt that in ways that are pretty significant.
My name is Lily Ningesha, hello. I just want you to talk more about Adela's sociality, and what I noticed in the beautiful images you shared is the one time she's really with peers is childhood, and then also because she's your friend. And so I'm just curious about, what kind of community she had throughout her adulthood and into the present, and sort of what is she like as a friend?
She's a little bit of work. We argue about politics. Aging is a motherfucker. And so a lot of what we talk about is what it means to sort of get older and still be queer and still be sexual and still go clubbing, and what shoes to wear. So that's what she's like as a friend. I mean, that's what we talk about. She has a lot of people. She's lived in San Francisco a really long time at this point. She did try to go to, I think it wasn't Miami. I told her Miami might have been better. It was another community in Florida. And like literally, I don't think she lasted 2 months. I don't think she liked those Cubans as much as she thought they would. So she came back. But a lot of the people from Proyecto, that group of people, very few of us can afford to live in the city anymore. A lot of people just left for other places, so there's no like kind of center there anymore. I bring her to talk to my classes. She gets a kick out of that. She loves all of these projects. Like, she'll talk to anybody. She loves all of these projects that people are sort of interested in her. Her friends are less. Like, well, how come she gets all this play? She is a very good storyteller. She's fun, funny, delightful. But community changes. Gentrification has really impacted how we're able to live community. Because there are things that happen in San Francisco that you sort of make it back to the city for, but it's not the same. It's more of a commitment.
We have time for one short question.
Thank you so much. I was also thinking about testimonio as a way of documenting the extraordinary suffering and traumatization that has been imposed on people as a way of beginning to try and bring to light what has been done by this country, other countries. So I was curious, because her persona is so brash, how you think about suffering in her experience.
In Sexilio, and just I think what was the most painful for her was what it meant to leave Cuba. And even though this "I will never return" is her line, she could. But her mother is there, and the kind of that loss is so hard. And you know, other people that have got political asylum, people that are undocumented and just can't cross the border. That is there's all kinds of, you know, all kinds of pain in the world. But I do think that exile has a certain, there's a depth to that that I think is hard to fill. Because even if there are other people to sort of hold you on wherever you land, that sense of not having a home to go back to is almost like not having a past to go back to. And so I think she feels that really strongly. Other pretty awful things have happened in her life, but what she sort of talks about, what I feel is the most on the surface for her now, like decades later, is what it meant to be Cuba.
Please join me in a round of applause for Maria. Also, just want to let you know that there is more food. Thank you, Cynthia, for coming through and being amazing. And our next panel will start in 15 minutes.